This episode originally aired on August 8th, 2021. A couple of episodes ago, we heard from Dr. Jeffrey Liker about the Lean framework for minimizing waste and maximizing efficiency. You may have also heard about Six Sigma. It's a framework for reducing the probability of creating defective products or delivering erroneous services down to less than 0.01%. Hi, I'm Alicia Butler-Pierre, and today we'll hear from another PhD with a focus on Six Sigma and how you can apply its principles to your organization. I remember when I first started learning about Six Sigma, I was intrigued by the fact that despite their best efforts, most large enterprises never achieve Six Sigma. And even more interesting is a personal observation I've made over the past 20 plus years. It has to do with the role that geography and a country's culture play in whether your Six Sigma project will actually be successful. And you're about to discover why that is, plus so much more. So grab a pen and paper to take notes. Our next masterclass is in session. Let's start the show.
Welcome to Business Infrastructure, the podcast about curing back office blues of fast-growing businesses. If you're a business owner or operator looking for practical tips and solutions to scaling your business in a sustainable manner, you're in the right place. Now here's your hostess, Alicia Butler-Pierre.
It's season 13 of the podcast, and if you haven't been here in a while, welcome back. If it's your first time listening, our theme this season is operational excellence. We're talking about what exactly it is and how you can achieve it. Joining us today in Corona, California, to contribute to this discussion is another special guest, Dr. Frank Barsi. And when it comes to operational excellence, he's an OG. Dr. Barsi worked in various technical lead positions for 40 years with companies like Boeing Aircraft, Lockheed Martin, and Parker Hannifin Aerospace Group. In fact, he helped develop projects like the primary flight controls for the F-35 and the F-22 Raptor, which is known as the best fighter jet in the world. And we are very privileged to be in his company today because he's going to share with us best practices for achieving operational excellence. Dr. Barsi, welcome. How are you today?
I'm feeling very well. It's in Southern California, over 100 degrees, but we are inside the air-conditioned buildings.
Awesome. I realized when you and I first met that I did not properly call you or address you as Dr. Barsi. I just kept saying, Mr. Barsi this, Mr. Barsi that. And it wasn't until I really looked at the bio that your daughter, Christina, shared with me that I said, oh, you know, I have to correct myself. So
well, now, that is understandable.
Now, you know, Dr. Barsi, not only are you a U.S. Army veteran, but you're also like a Six Sigma veteran as well. And I'm so glad that your daughter, Christina, connected us. Your background is so fascinating. And I know you're from Hungary originally, and you came to the United States as a teenager, and shortly afterwards, you joined the U.S. Army. What led your family to relocate here to America?
Well, it is a long story, but I'm going to make it very, very short. When I was very young, around 3 or 4 years old, my parents separated in Budapest, Hungary, and my mother emigrated to the United States. And I stayed with my father in Hungary, and that's where I was educated, schooled, and basically raised by my dad. Me and my brother, I have an older brother who's 4 years older than me. He's also a doctor, he's a veterinarian. So what really happened, I left Hungary. You have to understand, Hungary was a socialist country behind the Iron Curtain back in the early 70s, you know, and been that way since World War II. So I were not able to come to the United States or get out of Hungary without escaping Hungary. So I escaped Hungary. I basically swam to a lake between Hungary and Austria. And once the Austrian border patrol picked me up, I were able to contact my mother in New York, who lived in New York since my parents separated. Mm-hmm. And I were able to instantly emigrate to the United States because I was her son and I was underage. So I automatically qualified for legal status in the United States. As a,
wow.
They call it the green card status, mm-hmm. you know, the legal immigrant status. And of course, once I joined the military, the U.S. Army, I basically were able to get full citizenship once I become an adult.
Okay.
So this is how my American career started.
Wow. So you, what a story. Did your father know that you were leaving, or did you just kind of leave under the cover of night?
No, none of my family knew that. I originally belonged to a Jewish family, and I was connected to a Jewish organization who helped people escape from socialist countries, ultimately to go to America or go to Israel or so on. So what really happened, I escaped unannounced. Nobody knew what happened to me until I was gone and showed up in New York. And I swam 3 miles in October in a very cold water. I chose that way because there's Russian border patrol controlling to the western borders. Actually, it was me and two of my older cousins. Believe it or not, I'm the only one made it across. Both of my cousins were killed, shot at the border by the Russian border patrol.
Oh my gosh.
It was a very dramatic exit for me. You know, but I was not almost 16 years old, so like 15 and a half years old. I was an excellent swimmer because I was a member of the Hungarian water polo team for years. So
wow.
I could swim. So this is basically the short version of my story to get to the United States.
Oh my God. And you know, even though we've talked before, I didn't know this part of the story.
I would not put something like this in my bio or my other, you know.
No, but I think you should. I mean, wow. You know, we all talk about, you know, we all talk about freedom and democracy and you know, these ideals that certain countries espouse. But to hear this, I mean, this just adds a completely different perspective, I think, to everything that we're about to talk about also in this interview as well.
It's very interesting because I do talk to other immigrants and they all declare, you know what, I arrived to this country with absolutely nothing. I left the communist socialist Hungary or Soviet Union and so on. I always tell them, I left only in a swimming trunk. I really didn't bring nothing.
Just you and your dreams and those swimming trunks.
Exactly. But very interestingly, when I was 12 years old, I already know I will go to America and I will live in America. Mm-hmm. That was my dream. That was my goal. And I even made master plans on maps how to escape from communist Hungary to make that happen. And I was like 10 and a half years old already.
Wow. I mean, I have chills literally to... That's such a brave move. We, you know, especially with entrepreneurs, we talk about, you know, being entrepreneurs are extreme risk takers, and we do the things that other people aren't willing to do, and we're bold and we're daring. But my gosh, at 16 years old, to work up the nerve and courage to devise a master plan to escape with literally nothing, venturing and talk about venturing into the unknown, and to know that you lost some family members along the way, you know, it's just incredible. So you get to America, you reunite with your mother, and at that, I would assume you're close to you enroll in high school and graduate, or did you shortly thereafter enlist in the army as soon as you turned 18?
I was born in December 15th. So exactly when I turned 18, I right away went to the U.S. Army to prepare the test. And right after New Year's, I believe on 4th of January, I remember like it was today, I basically entered the service in the military. I took basic training in Fort Dix, New Jersey, and all my training then started going from then on. This is how I wind up in Louisiana, where you're mm-hmm. familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
My advanced infantry training was in Fort Polk, Louisiana. You know, then I went to Fort Benning for jump school, then Fort Bragg for ranger school. Then I did wind up in Vietnam.
You know? Wow.
You know? So I have a long, interesting thing before. But make a very short, I I served 3 years active duty and 3 years reserve forces. So when I left the active duty, I right away start working as a machinist. I grew up in a machine shop. My father was a master machinist and an engineer, you know, a tool and die maker. So I was very familiar with that profession. And I started going to school using the GI Bill. So basically, I was a volunteer when I went to the military. So I earned the GI Bill. So I could get, you know, housing, you know, with $1 put down the guaranteed loans. I could get education. So one of the rules was for 10 years after you separated from the service, you can go to school for 10 year long, and the U.S. Government will pay for it. So now I start using that money to go to school. So I started to various schools in Southern California. The very first degree I earned was a Bachelor of Science degree in mechanical engineering. Yes. And the very first job I got was not a mechanical engineer, but was a quality engineer. And was that's also have a very interesting story. I applied for a mechanical engineering job at an aerospace company in California, and they called me for an interview. After the interview, they informed me they can hire me, but not for the mechanical engineering job position, but the quality engineering position, because they don't actually have an opening for mechanical engineering. So I said, quality engineering. But interesting, I did not even know what quality engineering was.
I was just going to ask you that. Did you even know what that was? What did that mean?
I never even heard of the term.
Okay.
So I started investigating. So I started looking in the dictionary. They were not in the dictionary. None of the encyclopedia didn't even exist in there. Well, remember, I'm 65 year old today, and this took place over 40 years ago. Mm-hmm. You know, in the late 70s, when I just got out of the service, you know, and actually is an or a very early 80s, around that frame, Carter just became the president, you know, so that's
wow.
From Mr. Ford. I was in a service that Nixon was ousted that do the Watergate business, you know, from office. Mm. So this is the era. This is the 60s and the 70s hippie era when all this went on, you know. So the interesting thing was, I started working it, and I, very shortly I did realize that I did have a very good mechanical engineering background, and I started learning coil engineering from other coil engineers who worked at the department. Within 1 year, they made me the lead of their group, you know, because of my mechanical background. And of course, my accent was even a lot stronger back then. I even told them one time, you know, how can you guys sending me to making this training course and speeches, and I'm the one who speaks the worst English in the group? They said, no, we like that. When you speak, everyone listens.
I guess it was something different. Yeah.
They understand what you're saying.
That makes sense. They have to to listen. They have to pay very close attention to make sure they understand.
Yeah.
So what exactly is a quality engineer then? I know. It was just starting to get good, right? Well, there's more where that came from. To listen to the full interview, be sure to click the link in the description box below. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and click that notification bell so that you'll know when our next episode drops. Until then, keep operating smoothly.
Join us next week for another episode of Business Infrastructure with Alicia Butler-Pierre.